The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon. My name is Susan Ferrone, and I'm here to welcome Monica Rogers, the Health Information Literacy Coordinator, and she will be talking to us today about the PEMAT, the Patient Education Materials Assessment Tool. And this webinar is brought to you by Health Literacy Nebraska and NALID. If you have any questions, feel free to send them to us via the chat message. And Monica will also take, certainly you can write to her if you have other follow-up questions. We are being recorded, so this will be archived on the NALID website under Health Literacy Resources. And right now I'm going to change the presenter to Monica, and she will take it from here. Welcome, Monica.
Hi, everybody. So thank you for the introduction. I'm Monica Rogers, the Health Information Literacy Coordinator on behalf of the National Network of Libraries of Medicine. I've got an office over at Creighton University in Omaha, Nebraska, and we're going to talk about PEMAT. So that stands for the Patient Education Materials Assessment Tool, and that's from AHRQ. And so I already said that I'm here on behalf of the National Network of campus, and because I'm from the government, we like to collect lots of data. So I'm going to put in the chat box a very short two question only SurveyMonkey for you to fill out. Okay, let me change it so the chat can go to everybody.
It's to the entire audience?
Yes, please.
I just sent send the chat message.
Okay, great. Now I want to switch over so I can see my slides. Okay, Susan, do you have the, can you see my slides up?
You know what, if I just made myself the presenter here, how about if we just proceed this way for right now?
Okay. All right, so everybody listening, you can see my contact information there at the bottom. So if you have any questions either now during the webinar or follow up later, maybe you're looking at a patient education material 2 weeks from now and you need some help, just feel free to give me a call or send me an email. I'm happy to talk to you. So the objectives for today, we really only want you to be able to do two things when you leave it. Understand how to evaluate patient education materials, and then we also know how to evaluate it, and then ideally use PEMAT in order to do that. So before we get started, you're probably asking, what is PEMAT? Why should I care? So PEMAT is a systematic method to evaluate and compare the understandability and the actionability of some patient education materials. So it's from AHRQ, Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality. That link down there actually takes you to PEMAT. You can read through the whole guide, go through it step by step. But what PEMAT really is set apart is because it's looking at actionability as a separate item. So a lot of times when you look at patient education, we talk about making sure that it's at a good reading level and that we use plain language and that. But very rarely do we actually talk about if the material is something the patient can take action on. So the idea is we want them to be able to understand it. So, right, it process and explain key points once they get it. And then we want them to be able to identify what they can do next. So the item shouldn't just give them background information. They want them to be able to have the information and then do something later and actually carry it out or change their behavior or whatever it is that the patient education material wants them to do. It needs to be clear to them so they can take action. So there's two versions of PEMAT. There's a version for print items only. So that has from audio visual, which is the other format. So the print will talk about it, things like the organization of information on the page. Is there enough white space? Are they using items to draw the eye to things that are extra important? Like, do they have bullet points? Are things underlined? Are they in bold? Things like that. And then the audio visual version omits some of those items and then also looks at other things like, is there a summary at the end of the video? Is the video done at a speed where the patient is able to understand it or absorb each point of information as it comes to them? Is it too short, too long? Things like that. So as we go through each one of the items, I'll either have a little piece item so you know if this applies to print or if it applies to AV. So we do need to have a word of note about PEMAT. It is not comprehensive. So this is one of the tools in your tool. Accuracy of the material, it doesn't look at how comprehensive it is. So maybe you have information that is really helpful about dialysis, but it's not comprehensive because it doesn't talk anything about like kidneys or what they do or why they're important. Doesn't have any readability testing. So it doesn't look at reading level. It doesn't look at how many words I have in a sentence or how many syllables I have per word, stuff like that. And then if possible, ideally, under whatever circumstances, you would test your patient material with patients before you just go handing it out to everybody. So we know, of course, that is very rarely possible, but we do encourage it if you do have the chance to have a patient look at this, because a lot of times I end up with tunnel vision because I know what I'm talking about and it makes sense to me. So always a good reminder to test it with patients or an outside set of eyeballs. So the seven steps for actually working with PEMAT is we want you to read through PEMAT and the user's guide. If you actually read through the whole thing or at the very least kind of skim it, it gives you an idea on all the items that you're looking for. Because if you just go through the items one by one by one without looking at the, you're going to have a very hard time scoring it. So read through the whole shebang before you get started. Then we want you to read and review the patient education material in its entirety. Decide, of course, what PEMAT to use, is print or AV, that should be a breeze. And then actually go through it and check. This is how to rate the material. So things either score an agree, they get a 1 because they did it, or they get a disagree and a 0. This quote there is from page 11 of the handbook. The idea is that if 80 to 100% of the time it meets the guideline or whatever it is that we're looking for, then you consider agree. A lot of times with materials, you know, there might be room for improvement, but if we can get it about 80% of the time, we'll say that that's good enough. And then, of course, you just put not applicable if it just does not fit for whatever item that you're looking at. You get through, we go through all the items, you score PEMAT. This is how you actually calculate the score. You take how many points it got divided by a total possible times 100 gives you the score percent, and then interpret the PEMAT score. Ideally, the higher the score, the better, because it either gets a 1 because it passed or it got a 0 because it failed. So the higher the score, the better the material is. Or at the very least, the more confident you can feel when you give it to a patient that they'll be able to. So we're going to go through the items one by one. If anybody has any questions about them as we go through, please let me know. Because here I try to condense it a little, but the handbook itself gives supplemental examples. So if you're not clear on something and maybe you're like, oh, what would this look like in the item, go check the handbook because they will usually have really good examples of what something should look like if it were adhering to whatever item we're checking it for. So look at is the material makes its purpose completely evident. So a lot of times it looks evident, but it may or may not be to a patient who doesn't know anything. So we want to make sure that it has a really helpful title. So what will happen during your mammogram as opposed to mammograms in you? This is sometimes where we have a point of contention between having something that's a good health literate material and having glossy marketing. So mammograms in you probably is a nice short title that sounds, you know, more catching or more intriguing than what will happen during your mammogram. But remember, patient education is not meant to be marketing material. This is meant only to understand and take action. So PEMAT would choose the first one as agreeing, and the second one, it would get a zero. So item number two, the material does not include information or content that distracts from its purpose. Judgment call to make, because you have to decide what the intent of the material is and what they want the patient to do after, like, coming away after reading it. So, like, let's go back to the example for dialysis. Maybe it would be distracting if I spent two pages talking about kidneys and your renal system and what it does, why it's important, and then we meandered around into what is dialysis and care. If the intent of the patient education is to teach somebody about the renal system and the importance of dialysis, that's very different than patient education that you're giving to somebody who has already been diagnosed with kidney disease and their next step is to make an appointment and seek out care at a center to get dialysis, right? Those are, that has different intent. So you have to decide what information is needed to carry that out before you can really evaluate this number two and decide, okay, this information distracts from the purpose of the. Hope that makes sense. We get a little bit gray area. A lot of things in PMAT are judgment calls. So just if you need help, go back to that handbook. Maybe you can get some more feedback from there and decide if it fits or not. Item number three, the material uses common everyday language. So on the left-hand side, I have examples that you should use, runny nose, painkillers, to another doctor or a different doctor. Those kinds of things, we don't want to use the stuff on the right-hand side, like excessive mucus, you know, physician. Those kinds of things sound a little more clinical, and they're great in the clinical setting, but that, of course, is not what we want to use with patients. So use that plain language. We harp on this a lot in health literacy, and of course, it shows up in PMAT as well. Used only to familiarize audience with the terms, and when they are used, they are defined. So if you're going to talk about, let's say, a heart attack, you might want to define myocardial infarction so the patient knows that word is the medical term, and that's defined, and then you would say commonly known as a heart attack or whatever. If you're going to use the medical terms because you think that's important or you're talking about a particular anatomical item, like you want to talk about their terminal ileum, yeah, maybe you need is so that way when you talk about the terminal part of it, it makes sense. But you have got to make sure that's defined first. We can't assume that patients understand those words. Item number five, this is another one of those judgment call things. We want the material to use the active voice. So the active voice is take your medicine with a full glass of water. That is direct. It's speaking to the patient because it is an active voice, and it is immediately telling them what action to take, that they need to take their medicine with a full glass of water. That passive voice isn't as able. This medicine should be taken with a full glass of water. First of all, it sounds to be taken. Like, yeah, I should do a lot of things. That doesn't mean I actually do them. And then also, it kind of sounds like it just happens. Like, the medicine should be taken with a full glass of water. It doesn't direct me as the patient. It doesn't make me as a patient know that I am the one who needs to take action to get the water to take it with my medicine. So 80% of the time, at least, it should use the active voice direct, or it should address the patient directly and tell them what to do, not just sort of make it sound theoretical. Number six, numbers appearing in the material and easy to understand. We know that numbers or numeracy is a different subsection when we talk about skills and health literacy. So we want to make it really easy for people to understand the numbers that they have to interpret or at the very least apply to themselves. So that first example is usually a lot easier for people to. You have to express numbers, particularly when it comes to risk. People understand an expression frequencies much easier than a percentage. I know what 3 out of 10,000 people means or what it looks like, right? I could do an infographic about that. I could compare 3 people. It is much harder to try and explain to somebody what a 0.029% is. Right? If somebody told me I had a 0.29% chance of something, I'd be like, oh, what is that? Like, not much. It doesn't mean anything to me because I can't visualize it. So we want to have numbers that are expressed. Number seven, the material does not expect the user to perform calculations. This is a big one, because if we want patients to be able to understand something and then we alternately want them to take action, putting in barriers before they can take action doesn't help anybody. So if the idea is that we want them to, well, I don't know, lose weight because, or let's say we want them to be healthy and we want to evaluate their weight and you give them the formula to calculate their BMI, and I have one more thing I need to do to understand before I can even begin to understand or take action on my material. So if you need people to somehow have a math or something, give them a chart. Like, if you want to talk about BMI, don't put in the formulation for like how to calculate what your BMI is. Give a chart that has them just be able to look it up. Don't have them do math. Number eight, the material breaks or chunks information into short sections. So as we go through and we get up to like item 20 or 25, you'll see that PEMAT is very serious about this because PEMAT itself breaks it chunks into little sections. So make sure that the information in the patient education material does. A lot of times in health literacy, we talk about how, you know, you have 3 key points that somebody can walk away remembering. If you give them any more than 3, like, main chunks, they're going to get lost in the details. So make sure it's broken into easy, short sections for them to digest. And then, of course, related to this, number 9, the material sections have informative headers. So, again, this is where you can't have things like, let's say you want to talk about nutrition, you don't have a header that just says fruits or one that says vitamins, right? That as a user doesn't actually tell them if that section is important to them or applicable to them that they should read it. So you have to have informative descriptive headers just. And then item number 10, the material presents information in a logical sequence. This again is another one of those judgment calls. You have to decide what the purpose or intent of the material is first, then you can decide if it's a logical sequence. So if I am just having cancer education at a cancer center, and this isn't for somebody who's already been diagnosed or anything, then maybe it would make sense to talk about risk factors, lifetime risks of certain kinds of cancers. Like, you might talk about that background information because you're just doing education about cancer as a disease state. Somebody who was just diagnosed, it makes no sense to talk to somebody about how they ended up with cancer, right? It's too late. Nobody cares. They already have it. And we're focused on getting them well from the diagnosis forward. So decide what the purpose is and then say, is this in a logical sequence or not? Does it make sense for the person reading it? Item number 11, the material provides a summary. This again is a judgment call and directly proportional to the length of the material. So if I just have a short exercise video that shows different yoga poses or something and it's only a minute long, I probably don't need a summary, right? People's attention span can absorb a minute worth of material and then take action on it. Right, because if you give somebody 15 straight minutes worth of information, you need to have something at the end that reminds them of what they heard at the beginning or it's going to get lost. So summary, the longer it is, the more important a summary is. Number 12, the material uses visual cues. So this is another one of those things that is judgment call. How often do they use it? Are they doing arrows, boxes, bullets, bolding? What are they doing to try and get people's eyeballs to look at the important information? When it comes to AV, this also has to do with, are there slides in the video? Are they pop-up boxes? How are they trying to convey the information in addition to the visual portion? Excuse me. And then item number 13, text on the screen is easy to read. So I have three really poor examples of ways that I've seen in patient education to draw eyeballs. So we want to make sure that each other. We want to have things that draw visual cues, but at the same time do not present challenges to people who might have visual impairments. So we want to have it interesting looking and eye-catching and still understandable. Item 14, this is only for AV. The material allows the user to hear the words clearly. Not too fast, it's not garbled. There aren't shorts in the audio that cut in and out. This one is important, also a judgment call because it's related to if the AV item script and it's not like on YouTube or anything that has the ability to turn on closed captioning. Number 14 becomes really important. If you know that the video is on YouTube or all like NIH, Senior Health, and MedLine Plus videos, those all have a transcript with them. So that one is important, but less important the more assistive technologies or whatever we have for screen readers or closed captioning that you can do. So keep that in mind when you're scoring 14. 15, the material uses for choosemyplate.gov. So we know that patients learn in a variety of ways, right? We have visual learners, auditory learners, tactile, people who are more hands-on. So instead of just having text on the page, try to have visual aids whenever it could help your patient. Also, I know that when I am deathly ill, I don't want to have to think. So if you give me nice big pictures that are easy to understand, I'm much more likely to be able to like absorb the information, digest it, and then do something with it, as opposed to having to actually read something. Item number 16, the material's visual aids reinforce rather than distract from content. We're going to go through all three of these real quick and then talk about the two pictures. The material's visual aids have clear titles or captions. And then 18, the material uses illustrations and photographs that are clear and uncluttered. So I have two examples here. So the example on the left, there's nothing particularly like grievously wrong with it, except that it's sort of distracting, right? It doesn't reinforce the content because I don't know the last time I ever talked about a colonoscopy with my grandmother, nor did I accompany her on her visits. So this picture of like a young woman hugging what looks like maybe her grandmother talking about colonoscopy doesn't do anything. It doesn't add anything to the information. It doesn't explain it for me. It's just sort of there, and I wonder, like, why in the world they decided to include it. The caption explains something, but the caption is not at all related to the picture. So basically, the one on the left, I would never put in patient education, let alone in colonoscopies. But the one on the right, it says clean your baby's teeth with a clean soft cloth or baby toothbrush. It actually has a picture, right, of a little baby. Shows somebody who's cleaning their teeth with a soft cloth. That one would have like a score of 1. Item 19. The material uses simple tables with short and clear row and column headings. So if we do have to have a table, or maybe you're trying to express some data, we want to make sure that the tables are easy to understand and that the headings are short and clear. We don't want to have tables that confuse our readers any more than a table already does. And item number 20, the material clearly identifies at least one action the user can take. This is really important because this basically is the like item that everything hinges on, the actionability of the education. So we have two examples. The first one, be active longer each time. If you are walking 3 days a week for 30 minutes, try walking for an additional 10 minutes or more each day. So it uses the active voice, right? It says be active longer each time. It's telling me as a patient exactly what I need to do. And right, it's even giving me an example. Not only am I supposed to be active longer, it's saying if I'm already doing, it even gives me tips on how to incorporate that into what I'm already doing, and it's addressing me directly as a patient with the active voice. The second one, physical activity increases your chances of living a longer, healthier life. Like that example doesn't tell me as a patient what I need to do. It might imply it, but it doesn't tell me, so it's not actionable. And it also doesn't have the active voice, right? It just sounds kind of passive. Like physical activity increases your chances. I mean, it's not having our patients do what we want them to do later. It doesn't address them, doesn't tell them what to do. It just sort of sounds like a good idea, but not something they're actually going to take action on. Item 21, the material first items we talked about having the active voice. So here's just two examples, right? Direct, take your medication when you eat your meals. Indirect, medicine should be taken at meal times. This is a good example of not only when like addressing the voice, but it is much more actionable the first time. Because like let's say I work, you know, a swing shift or something, or I'm, you know, 24 on, 12 off, whatever it is, and talking about medicine should be taken at meal times. Like meal times for regular people would be, you know, 8 a.m., noon, and 7 p.m. As a swing worker, maybe my meal times are totally different. This is not particularly helpful for me with the second section. The first one is clearly telling me to take it when I have food. Those are different directives, so we want to make sure that our patients are following the direct one at the top and actually has instructions for them and tells them what action to take. Item number 22, the material breaks down any action into manageable, explicit steps. This is a big one, and it's something we talk about a lot when it comes to, like, goal planning, right? If you set a goal that says, I'm going to lose 20 pounds, you need to have steps in between there because you don't just wake up one day and have lost 20 pounds. You need to have manageable, explicit steps. So if the goal make a meal plan. Your next step would be to incorporate exercise into your routine. And then you would break it down into explicit steps, right? We don't tell somebody to start exercising because that sounds sort of nebulous and also impossible. Like start exercising what, where, how long, what should I do? It's not telling them what actions to take. And maybe it sounds in general like exercise more is a pretty easy thing to do, but unless you give them specific actions and steps to take, there's just more barriers to them actually doing it. So make sure everything is broken down, easy to read. A lot of times I compare it to like baking instructions. Step by step, how things, when things, and in what order things need to be done. Make sure that your patient education material is modeled in the same way. Ideally, they would even have them numbered so they can say, okay, I did step number two or whatever it is in the sequence. And item number 23, the material provides a tangible tool, meal planners, checklists, something like that, whenever it could help the user take action. This is also one of those things where if you give it to let's say we do want somebody to lose weight and get in shape or whatever it is, and if you say that they should eat healthy, it would be super helpful if you had a meal planner for them so they could actually plan out their meals, or a sample menu so they can say, oh, okay, now that I understand what a healthy meal should look like, I can model mine after theirs. Whatever it is, you want to give them a tool or something tangible so they can use it to take action. I don't know if it's a psychological thing about it, but there's something when somebody like sends me off into the world to go do something, there's always that moment of like, oh, I'm on my own to figure this out and make it happen. If you give me a tool, I feel more prepared. Like, oh, yes, this is not just me doing this. It's me, and I have this to help me carry out this action. It's a different approach. Help you do it. So whenever it is possible, please make sure the patients have the tools that they need to do what they need to do. Item number 24. I already cautioned about how you should never make your patients do math. But if for whatever reason, absolutely cannot get around it, there's no way to avoid it, there's no charts, there's no nothing you can do, they absolutely have to do math, you should treat it like a fourth grade like word problem. You need to spell it out step by step, explain why they're doing it, and then have an example of exactly what it is you want them to do. So this is an example of it. You're trying to explain to somebody how long their inhaler would last. They actually walk them through it as though it's a word problem. If you use two puffs each time, and you use your inhaler four times a day, you have to have it that explicit. So ideally, that way when they're trying to do their own math, they would just plug in their own numbers to the equation and it would give them the answer, because we don't want to make this any harder than it is. This is something I stress so much. We are asking patients, right, to understand and be able to communicate, and like health literacy is already a bunch of skills that they need to do. Math skills are a whole nother beast. So when we're looking at patient education materials, you're trying to teach the patient not only about whatever health-related item you want them, but when you have something like item number 24 here, you're trying to teach them about health and also teach them how to do math. So if you absolutely cannot avoid it and you must make them do math, have it like they spell out for this one. Make it as easy for them to understand as possible. Item 25, the material explains how to use the charts, graph, tables, or diagrams to take action. So I included an example of the nutrition facts. A lot of times this is a good example of including a chart or a graph does not always help patients. We put nutrition fact labels on all of our food. That doesn't mean that they either understand it, or if they understand it, how to incorporate that into their decision making and take action on it. So this is a good example of explaining nutrition facts. And then ideally, once somebody knows how to use the chart or graph or whatever it is, then they can take action after that, because just giving them nutrition facts 26. The material uses visual aids whenever they can make it easier to act on the instructions. So this is, again, very closely related to a previous item where we talked about having visual aids that makes it easier to understand. This is understanding and then acting on the instruction. So about healthy foods and what is more healthy than others, but they should be able to take action on it, right? They understand that a green light means go and that a red light means stop or whoa and that they should proceed with caution. So here are the links to the scoring sheets for print and AV. You're welcome to go look at them and check them out. This is actually what the scoring sheet in PEMAT looks like. So it gives you the item, exactly what we're looking for, and then over here on the right-hand side, you either give it a 1 or a 0. The scoring sheet, like this is a screenshot of it. It's very brief. So if you wanted some background information or you're not really sure how to decide if it's informative headers, that's when you need to turn to the handbook that actually gives more examples. And then you can see I have a couple here that are saying very short agree, like they're not applicable. So this is where you decide, oh, I'm looking at AV more. It's too short. It doesn't need a summary, whatever it is. And then you just put NA over here. You don't give it a score. So the scoring sheet is very easy to use. We already talked about the math behind it. PEMAT does a great job of explaining how to do the calculations, and it gives you several examples. So if you ever need help scoring PEMAT, let me know. Otherwise, it adhered to its own principles and explains it well. These are just a couple of example practice items that we can look at. So item number 5, the material uses the active voice. So if you guys want to put in the chat box, which should use, if it should be the first one or the second one. So the first one reads, if you see redness, see your healthcare provider. And the second one is, if redness is observed, the patient should see a healthcare provider. So which one would we actually want to have on an understandable and patient education? So we're going to talk about all the reasons why the second one is wrong. So we already know it doesn't use the active voice because it's saying is observed, not me as the patient sees it. It also uses the word observed as opposed to see or seen, right? We want to use plain language on that. And then also, the patient should see a healthcare provider. It sort of sounds, but like it's optional, like maybe I don't have to do it, I should, I ought to, but this is not ideal in any sense of the word. Doesn't use the active voice, it doesn't explain, it also isn't actionable, it doesn't tell them what to do next. So the second one is very similar along those same lines. The patient is seen by the heart attack specialist after a heart attack, or the second one, the patient visits the heart attack specialist after a heart attack. Again, happens to the patient, like the heart attack specialist is around and they see them, it's not telling them to take action, like that they should see their heart specialist and go from there. Item number 6, for practice, numbers appearing in the material are clear and easy to understand. So the first one, take one pill in the morning, versus the second one, take twice daily. There are all kinds of scenarios in which take twice daily can be misinterpreted. Maybe to me that means I take it twice at the same time, or maybe I take one now and I take one an hour later. It's not telling me how long it should be between them. The first one, at the very least, it tells me I should take one in the morning and one at night. That helps me with patient compliance. So that second one, yeah, but it fails PEMAT in a lot of ways. And then item 9, the material sections have informative headers. So safe cooking temperatures versus merely temperatures, right? Temperatures doesn't really tell me much. The temperature outside, inside, how hot I should cook things, I have no idea what that means. if you tell me it's about safe cooking temperatures, I can know exactly what it is, cooking temperatures, and that they're safe, and I could probably get out on that and decide that that's for things that it matters how hot it is, like if it's safe cooking temperatures for different kind of meats or things like that. Whereas temperatures, I mean, you could be talking to me about all kinds of things. And as a patient, I'm probably not going to be interested. In the last two practice items, so the material clearly identifies at least one action the user can take. This is actually the example that I pulled from an item when I was looking at patient education. The first example, as a patient, doesn't tell me much of anything. 91% of bicyclists killed in 2009 weren't wearing helmets. Like, oh, okay, so what? Like, as a patient, what does that mean for me? The second one that says, make sure your children wear helmets, tells me as a parent my action is that I need to make sure my kids wear helmets. That's very different than just telling me that people that don't wear helmets get killed. I don't know what to do with that information. I don't have any actions to take. Item 21, again, this is very tied into those other things about using the active voice and telling them what they need to do. So you can find it at your drugstore versus patients can find it at their drugstore. That sounds to me like it's other patients, right? Patients can find it at their drugstore. That's those people's problem, not me as a reader and a patient who also needs to find it at my own drugstore. So you can find it at your drugstore, much better. It tells me what I need to do as a patient. And then the second one, patients should arrange a ride home after the procedure versus arrange a ride home after the procedure. That other example, arrange a ride home, kind of sounds optional, especially for me as a patient. Maybe I don't want to arrange a ride home. I don't have alternate transportation, or I don't, whatever it is, don't have the time, not concerned. I could just opt out of it and say, oh, I'll be able to get home just fine. That second one doesn't give me an option. It says I have to arrange a ride home and that there's no way that I can get home myself. We need to make sure that the patients clearly understand what they absolutely need to do, not make it sound optional or like maybe it's not going to happen. Okay, so I have two very that I will play. Susan, if you can have it, so I can share my screen. Let's see.
Oh, I'm changing the presenter. You, Monica?
Okay, great. All right, and I'm able to show my screen. Okay, so hopefully everybody can see my screen. So we're first going to, this is, as you can see, patient education on gout.
Gout is caused by increased production of uric acid. Uric acid crystals travel and accumulate in the joints, especially in the feet and legs, causing great pain and swelling.
Okay, so that was brief, probably so short that we didn't need a summary, so it passes that on the PEMAT. But it fails in a lot of ways. I am not sure, maybe as a judgment call you could disagree, but I don't particularly think that this aid of these little sparkly items are very informative or add to the fact or might add to the understanding of what uric acid is, right? As a patient, I still don't understand what uric acid is or what it looks like or what contributes to an increase. So I don't know what to do about it afterwards. Like, let's say I have gout and I watch this video. I have nothing to take action on. And then also, later on they do this, they show me joints. That doesn't tell me anything that problems that I'm facing or just blinking lights about my joints don't help my gout problem, nor do they help me take action on what I'm supposed to do because I have it. So this is an example of some patient education that maybe passes some PEMAT items, but ultimately fails on a lot of other counts. So here is another example. This is about gout. This obviously wasn't even intended to necessarily be patient. A clip from an episode of King of the Hill. And we're going to watch it, and at the end of it, we'll score it on PEMAT and see if it fared any better or any worse than the patient education from gout that we got from Medline Plus.
Well, gout occurs when uric acid crystals form in the bloodstream and collect in an extremity, like Bobby's big toe.
Now, hold on. Maybe turf toe was a pipe dream, but gout? That's an old man's disease.
Hey. Help your old boy to get gout. But it happens. Like that feral boy they found surviving on pig excrement. What you need to do is quit pumping your boy full of purine-rich foods.
And those are?
Preserved fish like anchovies or herrings and organ meats, you know, kidneys, hearts, liver.
The boy's not a ghoul. He doesn't eat that stuff.
The liver. Because that's what's on a Louis Anderson.
What?
I've been getting it at the showbiz deli.
Oh, Bobby's gout will clear up if he stays off those deli foods. In the meantime, I thought this might help.
Does it come with a hat?
So that is, I think, a really good example of sort of a teachable moment or a health literate moment in pop culture. So comparatively speaking, this video wasn't particularly long. I don't feel like it needed seconds exactly, so we're under a minute. Probably doesn't need one. It did do a little more education than the other gout video. It actually tells us how somebody would get gout, right? That they're eating purine-rich foods. We know what foods those are, i.e. chopped chicken liver sandwiches from the Showbiz Deli. And then as a patient, we also know what to do next, right? If we have gout and my next action is to lay off those foods and keep off my feet. So this wouldn't necessarily pay because it's lacking in a lot of other things, right? The information isn't necessarily presented in a logical sequence. It talks about other things that are definitely distracting when we're looking at it from a patient education angle. And there's some other considerations that, you know, we would have to take in. So this ultimately failed PEMAT, but we can say that this already scored higher than something that was intentionally made to be patient education. So we sort of had a total fail on the first one. This is sort of a medium, like if we really couldn't find any better sort of, oh, we could make it work if we had to. But then now, this last video we're going to watch, we will score it on PEMAT. It's not on gout, but it's on a different subject, and we'll see what its official score is, how well it would do. For the record, this actually had a different header. It was under the section for falls, and then this was the subsection. So it does have an informative header. You just can't see it because I skipped that step.
Let's look at specific things you can do to make your home can increase your chances of falling. With a few changes, your home environment can be made safer. Eliminate clutter. Notice how the floor and walkway are clear of rugs, papers, landscaping, and avoid tripping. Check your stairs. Are they clear of clutter? Do they have available handrails on both sides? Make sure light switches are clear. Improve lighting. Make sure light switches are easy to reach. Use a night light to improve your safety if you have to get up in the middle of the night. Make your bathroom safe. There are many things you can do to reduce your chances of falling in the bathroom. Use a non-slip mat in the shower or bathtub. Put hand railings in the bathtub and around the toilet, and keep your floor dry. Always wear shoes, and pick shoes that are sturdy, and wear them inside and outside of the home.
Okay, so that video at a minute and 22 seconds did not have a summary. It probably doesn't necessarily need one based on the length. Though, I will say, if I were a senior and I needed to make my home safer because I was worried about falls, that seems like a lot of things for me to do and take action on. And I may or may not remember all of the items or all the actions that the video wanted me to take. So that is a judgment call. Maybe you think it needed a summary or maybe not. But hopefully we can agree that that was very actionable. It had several examples of things it actually wanted patients to do, and it always used the active voice. Make sure your light switches are nearby. Clear things out. It's telling the patient exactly what they need to do to take action. And then also had informative headers so that this was home safety falls. And then it also even almost had like headers in the audio. Bathroom safer. And then the next sentence was, there are many things you can do to make your bathroom safer. So if this is in a transcript, I would imagine that that would have almost served as a header, and then it would have gone into the body of how you actually make your bathroom safer. So I thought those were three good examples of like a total fail, a mediocre, and then this one would have gotten like an A++. They showed were of actual people's homes, so you could see what their house looked like. It wasn't a cartoon drawing or anything distracting. And all of the pictures of the home actually had examples. So it had a picture of the bathroom with a handrail or it right next to it with that light switch in reach. So I'm going to give up my screen, I think, so I'm not sharing anymore. And does anybody have any questions or any comments?
Are you there, Monica?
Yep, I'm still here.
Okay.
Okay, I'm not hearing any questions, and I don't see any questions in the chat box.
Okay. Well, I just wanted to thank Monica. For being here today, and wanted to remind folks to fill out the summary or the SurveyMonkey. And if you have any questions, please contact Monica. Sorry about the echo. All right, thank you very much. And have a good day.